Christmas to you all. I'd invite you to let's stand together and lift our voices in song on these first three Christmas songs that we'll sing together. Let's sing.
The first Noel, the angel did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields as they lay, keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep.
Why? Good morning. My name is Steve Kilgore. I'm one of the pastors here at Calvary Church, and it's my privilege on this last Sunday of 2015 to welcome you and to be able to greet you this morning. It's the last Sunday, but we know that it's somebody's first Sunday. And if you are here for the very first time today, we want to especially welcome you and thank you for choosing to come and worship with us this morning. It's our privilege to have you join us as we conclude our series, Unpacking the Nativity. If you are here for the first time, or if you're new to Calvary, we'd encourage you to attend our welcome gathering, which is a short session right through the doors to the east side of the lobby. And you'll see a sign there for the welcome gathering where you can get to know a little bit more about Calvary Church. Usually our senior pastor is there. When he gets up and you hear his voice, you may know that he might not be there today. But we're hoping that his voice holds out today. We also want to encourage you, if you're new to Calvary, to put January 10th on your calendars. That's the next time we offer Discover Calvary, an opportunity to hear the vision and values and the direction of the church. It's an opportunity to get to know a little bit more about what's going on and what's coming. And you want to mark that. There are a lot of exciting things coming. We had been planning a number of things for this new year, and with a little bit of a traffic issue with the bridge that's out, we're having to accelerate a few things, and we'd love to for you to be praying about that as we go into the new year. You might even hear that we're offering lunch to keep you around a little bit to let the parking lot end. And some of the moms already are celebrating that they won't have to cook. So keep that, just we're working towards some of those things to help with the parking issues. We also want to say thank you on this last Sunday of the year for your faithful giving to Calvary all year. We are very thankful for the faithfulness and the consistency of the giving here at Calvary, and we don't take it for granted. Many of you have given extra at the end of the year to help us meet our needs and to prepare for the new year. If you'd like to do that, there's a note in the bulletin for instructions, as the office will not be open all week, but there is some instruction there if you'd like to give at the end of this year, and we will be very grateful for that as we plan things moving into the new year. And as we do move to the new year and the plans for that, we want to turn all of that to the Lord as we prepare for our message this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that as we gather on this last Sunday of 2015, that we can both celebrate and continue to celebrate the birth of Jesus and look ahead to the new year. We are mindful that you are the God of time, and there is nothing that is coming before us in this new year that we would be unexpected to you, but that you are a sovereign God who is in control. And we pray that as we prepare for the new year and as we live in that new year, that we will be a people who trust you. As we trust you to lead and guide us in this new year, we pray that the messages that we've been hearing of the reality of the incarnation as we've unpacked the nativity, that those truths will be carrying us forward as we trust you and thank you for all that you have done to provide for us and to redeem both our lives from sin, but also to give us a meaning and a purpose for life as well. And we pray that you will help us to live in the unknown of this new year in a way that brings you honor and glory. And Father, we are thankful for the way that you have blessed us, both as a church and individually, and we now give our gifts to you as a response of gratitude for what you have done for us. And we know that we cannot pay you back or earn any element of what you have given to us, but we return to you a portion of what you have given to us, so that you may use it here and around the world for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Well, amen. We're so thankful for these Talbot sisters able to be with us this morning to help us lead in worship. Let's stand again together, shall we, as we sing about this great God who came to save. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Bo Eckert. I'm the senior pastor here at Calvary Church, and as Steve Kilgore mentioned, I don't have much of a voice. Oftentimes, I come up here on the platform and have some sort of object or prop or illustration. Today, I have my water bottle and my cough drops. We preached on grace encounters, so I'm asking the family of Calvary Church and any guests that might be with us to show me some grace this morning. I've been sick all week long. After the Christmas Eve service, my voice was gone. My kids will remember this Christmas is the Christmas that Dad didn't talk but wrote on the whiteboard what he wanted to communicate. So we're making memories all over the place, and I'm sure that this morning will be memorable. Maybe not all for the right reasons, but we're going to do our best to get through this. We got through the first service, and we're going to get through this one as well. We are at the end of our Unpacking the Nativity series, and what a month it has been. I don't want to single anyone out, but I also want the people of Calvary Church just to recognize, and I just want to acknowledge all of the people that had a part in putting all of this together. Everything that you have seen and experienced, the paintings that were done, the stable was made from scratch, the idea of having the cutouts and then they come to life on Christmas Eve. For those that were here on Christmas Eve, I know it's a little bit of a letdown that, you know, nothing's real up here. There's no animal droppings anymore the way that there were on Christmas Eve. But to me, those sheep on Christmas Eve, I'll never forget them. So I just want to thank so many people that did so much great work behind the scenes. We're grateful for all that they've done, and we hope that it has helped you to see and understand your own nativity in a little bit of a different way and a deeper way this Christmas season. If you weren't here on Christmas Eve, we gave everyone a Christmas card from Calvary Church that has the image for this series. It has the four paintings on them. If you didn't get one, you should have gotten one maybe as you came in today. They're spread out all over the lobby. I think we literally have hundreds left, so take several of them. We hope this becomes a great reminder. Use it as a bookmark. Put it on your fridge. Get it out every Christmas season to help you to remember the nativity and what this series has meant. We ask for many of your pictures of your nativities. They're hanging in the lobby. Feel free at the end of the morning to take your picture with you if you want it. You can also get them next week if you want to take those pictures with you, so feel free to do that today. Next week, you'll notice on the back of your bulletin, we're starting a three-week series called What Child Is This? And you say, well, I thought Christmas was over. I thought we're putting the nativity away. Well, before we put our nativity away, we actually want to unpack who Jesus is. We've talked about his coming and why he came, but you can see it's really a series on Christology. Who is Christ? And next week we'll talk about the two natures of Christ and then really focus in on the humanity and then the deity of Christ over those next 2 weeks. So join us as we begin that series to start the new year. But today, we focus in on the wise men and the star. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 2. It's found on page 807 in the Pew Bible in front of you. And the wise men will enter the scene today. But really, I want you to focus in on the star. Most of us have wise men that are a part of our nativities. But I would venture to guess that many of you don't have a star that's part of yours. Now, some of you, you know, and you can think about it. Some of you are going to have to go home and check. But it's difficult to add a star to the nativity. For those that do, it might be kind of hanging above or attached to the top of the stable. But I hope that maybe by the end of our time together this morning, you might say, you know what? I didn't really think about the star playing that significant a role, and maybe we need to add a star to our nativity because of the role that it plays in the Christmas story. So we want to focus in on the star today and the role that it plays. And one of the roles that the star plays is the star becomes an invitation for the wise men. The star invites them into the story. And here's how I want you to think about this morning. We're going to unpack the star and what it meant and what it did for the wise men. But the star invited them into this story. And I believe that God continues to invite people into his story. For some, he is still using the stars. The scriptures tell us that the heavens declare the glory of God. And there are some people, when they look up in the stars, they understand that there is a creator, and it begins their journey towards God. But as God continues to invite people into his story, he uses lots of different things all along the way. If we were able to interview the wise men today and ask them about their journey and their story and how they were led to Jesus, the star would be the star of the story, wouldn't it? But what about your story? It might not be a star, but if I were to ask your story and ask about your journey towards Jesus, and maybe some of you are still on that journey, maybe some of you are still seeking, and if I were to ask you about your journey, it might not be a star, but you might be able to tell me about some circumstances that took place in your life. Some key moments or some key events that began you on that journey. For some of you, it started with a tragedy. You see, you were going through life and life was working out really well for you, and then a tragedy came and it kind of sent your world spinning. And it began you on a quest and on a journey that ultimately ended up at Jesus. For some of you, you could point back to a conference or a service or a retreat. For some of you, it was a specific message that somebody preached at a particularly important time in your life. God still is using lots of different means to bring people to himself. God is active, God is involved, and God is inviting people into his story, inviting people to participate. The wise men were invited by a star. And as we see the role that the star played in their lives, I want you to think about some of the implications of that in your life. Because in some regards, the role that the star played for them is the same role that a certain event or circumstance or tragedy played in your life. So not by way of application, but by way of implication, we're going to try to make those connections as we look at this story and see what it means for us and our story. So the first thing that the star does for these wise men is it interrupts them. It interrupted their flow. It interrupted what was going on in their life. Here's what it says in Matthew chapter 2 in verse 2. The wise men said, "For we saw his star when it rose." I just want to camp there just for a moment. The reason this interrupted them is because there was orderliness and there was predictability to the universe. And as these wise men, they probably weren't kings, magi, maybe they were astronomers or astrologers, maybe they were from Babylon, which was the NASA of the ancient world. Because they were looking, Because they understood the patterns of the skies, they knew that something different and unique was happening and taking place. And it interrupted them. It interrupted their life. And it interrupted them to the point that they knew that this was something significant that they needed to pay attention to. And as we look at this, it begs the question for some of us, well, what was this star that interrupted them? Was it a planet? Was it a meteor? Was it a comet? Was it just a miraculous light that God brought and it wasn't a natural occurrence? It's worthwhile to look at that if you're into that, and it's worthwhile to dig in. There was a book that's recently been written by Colin Nickel that some evangelical apologists are calling maybe the defining work about the star. He believes that the star was a comet. And I watched an hour-long interview with him this week, and he has some really intriguing things to say. And if you're into that, that's something for you to take a look at and explore further. But as we explore these types of happenings that we are told about in Scripture, there is a warning that comes with it. It's worth digging into some of the natural events and miraculous events of Scripture and trying to understand what happened and how they happened and how this could have worked. It's worth doing that, but there is a danger of going too much to an extreme. And as I was preparing this, I came across a quote about the star by John Piper, and to me it's worth reading it to you this morning. It's too long to put on the screen. But there's a little warning in here that I know I need to be careful of, and others maybe need to be careful of as well. Again, I don't think this is saying that we don't dig in and do our research, but we have to be careful that we don't make too much of it. Here's what Piper says. He says, people who are exercised and preoccupied with such things as how the star worked and how the Red Sea split and how the manna fell and how Jonah survived the fish, and how the moon turns to blood, are generally people who have what I call a mentality for the marginal. A mentality for the marginal. You do not see in them a deep cherishing of the great central truths of the gospel, the holiness of God, the ugliness of sin, the helplessness of man, the death of Christ, justification by faith alone, the sanctifying work of the Spirit, the glory of Christ's return, and the final judgment. They always seem to be taking you down a side track with a new article or book. There is little centered rejoicing. I think there's a warning in there for all of us. It's not a rebuke, but it's just be careful. Be careful that we don't have a mentality for the marginal, that we're not trying to make too big of a deal about some of the miraculous things that God did and trying to find an explanation for it all. And I love the way he ended that. There is little centered rejoicing. And by centered rejoicing, I think he's bringing us back to the centrality of the gospel. And are we focused in on the centrality of the gospel and rejoicing in what God did, or are we too caught up in marginal issues? So that's not an excuse to not dig in and try to understand what the star was, but I think there's a balance there when we do that. The star interrupted them, just in the same way your life has been interrupted by things that may be from God, maybe God trying to get your attention. What do you do when God interrupts? Well, let's see what they did. When they were interrupted, the star then motivated them. The star motivated them to move, to act, to be involved, to seek out more information. Matthew 2, verse 1. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. They were interrupted by the star, and the star actually motivated them to do something, to seek out and to get more information. This would have been inconvenient. It would have cost them something. If they did come from Babylon or somewhere in that region, it probably would have been over 500-mile journey for them to get there. How did they know to come to Jerusalem? Why did they come to Jerusalem? Did God provide direct revelation to them? Had they done their research? If they were from Babylon, hundreds of years before, Daniel spent some time in Babylon. Daniel had prophecies about the coming of the King of Jews, the coming of the Messiah. Were these prophecies not only handed down in the Jewish scriptures, but were they handed down to the wise men in Babylon that they knew to be on the lookout? Did they know that in Numbers 24, it talked about the star of Jacob coming? Did they have this information that motivated them to move and motivated them to continue seeking and to continue to find out more about what was taking place? The star interrupted them. The star motivated them. The star provoked them. The star provoked several people in this story, and we're going to see the way that the different people in this story responded to the provoking that was taking place in their life. We're actually going to look at three responses of the people in this story. And I want to challenge each of you to think about how you respond when God provokes you with something spiritually in your life. First, the wise men. They were interrupted, they were motivated, they were provoked, and it caused them to seek. It caused them to be curious. It caused them to ask more questions. Verse 2. Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? They knew enough to know that they didn't know everything. They knew enough to know that they needed more information to get their answers. As I said, how did they know that this star was proclaiming the birth, not just of an important person, but a king? And not just any king, but the King of the Jews. And as we're going to see in a moment, whether it was their understanding or whether it was Herod's understanding or whether it was just from the scribes and the chief priests that were involved, they understand this was more than just an earthly king that was born. You see, I don't think they would have made this journey if it was just another earthly king. See, they weren't coming to see King Herod, who was called King of the Jews. They weren't coming to see Herod's heir. They knew enough to come because they knew that there was something significant and special about this King of the Jews, that he wasn't just going to usher in another earthly kingdom, but this was from God, and he was going to usher in God's kingdom. So they asked questions. They sought more answers. And then we get some more characters that are introduced to this story. Verse 3. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled. Why was Herod troubled? Herod is near the end of his life. Herod was a control freak. Herod was concerned about his legacy. Herod killed people in his own family to protect his kingdom and to protect his own legacy. So when Herod heard the news that another king had been born, this troubled him. But it not only says that he was troubled, but all Jerusalem with him. Now, why was the rest of Jerusalem troubled? Because when Herod was troubled, everybody else was troubled as well. You didn't know what he was capable of. You didn't know what he was going to do. So if Herod was upset, everybody was on edge. Verse 4. So he called together the Jewish leaders. He called together the chief priests and the scribes, and he inquired of them where the King of the Jews was to be born. Is that what it says? No, he didn't ask where the King of the Jews was to be born. He asked where the Christ was to be born. He asked where the Messiah was to be born. Did he get this information from the Magi, from the wise men, to make the connection that, hey, what we're talking about here is the promised one, the Messiah? Did the wise men know who they were truly seeking, who this star was leading them to? Herod made the connection that it wasn't just an earthly king of the Jews, but this was the Messiah, the Christ child. So he calls together the Jewish leaders and says, hey, I need some more information. I need some more information about what's happening and what's going on here. Herod probably should have known, but he calls in the experts. So Herod is introduced to the story, the scribes and the chief priests are introduced to the story, and in the same way that the wise men have been provoked, I believe that Herod has been provoked, and I believe that the scribes and the chief priests have been provoked. Let's see how these two respond as well. First, the wise men. Herod asks them a question. They point back to the Old Testament, to the book of Micah, and they answer his question in verse 5 and 6. They say, in Bethlehem of Judea, for it's been written by the prophet, you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel. They give him the answer to the question. He said, where is Messiah supposed to be born? They give him the answer, in Bethlehem, 5 miles away from where they were. In Matthew's account, this is the last we hear about the involvement of the scribes and the chief priests in this story. I know this might be an argument from silence, so I'm not saying it's biblical fact. I'm just asking you to think a little bit. How did the scribes and the chief priests respond to the news that the wise men brought, that they were following a star, that the king of the Jews has been born, to Herod's request of, where is this Messiah to be born? And when they gave the answer, did the scribes and Pharisees say, this is it. This is the one that we've been waiting for. This is the one that the scripture has pointed to. All of us, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's go see if it's really true. Maybe it's not true, but hey, it's not that far of a journey. Let's go check it out for ourselves. Matthew doesn't tell us that that happened. Luke doesn't tell us that that happened. Nowhere in scripture do we have any record that that happened or occurred. Maybe it did, but I don't think it did. In response to being provoked, the wise religious leaders of the day seem to be indifferent. They seem to be indifferent to what was going on. If there was anybody that should have been looking and ready and prepared and to go investigate and to see what was going on, it should have been them. But I think their response was a response of being indifferent. The wise men's response was one of curiosity, asking questions, seeking. I think the scribes and the chief priests were indifferent. And I think there's a danger in that for you and me. I think there's a danger in that for us in Lancaster County. I think it's easy for us to go through the motions religiously, but in the end be indifferent to the Christ child. One of the scariest verses in all of Scripture occur a little bit later in Matthew's gospel. When people come before the judgment and Jesus says, depart from me. But wait a minute. Didn't we prophesy? Didn't we cast out demons? Didn't we do all these good works? He says, yes, you did all of those things, but you never knew me. You never had a personal relationship with me. What that might look like for us today. Didn't I go to church every Sunday? Didn't I put money in the offering basket? Didn't I pray for all those missionaries? God would say, yeah, you did all those great things. But you never knew me. You sang songs about Christ the Savior being born, but he never became your Savior. You never made it personal. You never accepted that free gift. You thought it was enough just to go through the motions. Let's not be like those scribes and Pharisees. When God is provoking us in our life, let's have soft hearts and respond to Him. The wise men sought and were curious. The scribes and the priests were indifferent. How does Herod respond? Verse 7. Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and he said, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him." Now, I don't need to read or tell you the rest of the story for you to know Herod's not being genuine here. Was he seeking Jesus? Absolutely, he was seeking Jesus because he wanted to kill him, because he was a threat to him. Herod's response to being provoked was a response of hostility. And isn't it true that there's still people today that when they are provoked spiritually, when God does something in their life, they respond with hostility towards him? Some people seek and ask questions and are curious. Some people are indifferent, but some people are hostile. Is that you? Was that you at one time in your life? Were you hostile to the gospel of Jesus Christ, but then God brought something into your life? God provoked you and motivated you and interrupted your life, and your eyes were open for the very first time. There's other people that you know right now that are hostile to the message of the gospel. But I believe that God is going to do something. God is still inviting and leading and directing and bringing people to himself. How do we respond? Are our hearts soft to respond? Herod's wasn't. Herod was interested in protecting and preserving and controlling his own kingdom. And I think there's a little bit of Herod in each and every one of us, isn't there? Don't all of us have this little bit of, I want to protect, I want to control, I want to preserve. It's my life, it's my kingdom. And he went to severe and completely inappropriate means to protect his legacy and protect his kingdom. Instead of doing what the wise men did and coming and seeking and eventually bowing down and worshiping. It's a reminder to us that on our journey to God, there's going to be some people that are going to be obstacles towards that journey. They didn't know it, but Herod was an obstacle to them for their journey. When God provokes you, when God is working in your life, do you respond like the wise men, or do you respond like the scribes or Pharisees, or do you respond like Herod? The star interrupted, the star motivated, the star provoked, the star directs. We've seen it direct them to Jerusalem. It rose and directed them to get to Jerusalem. But now we see how it continues to direct them. Verse 9. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them. Gives the indication that this was moving, that maybe it appeared and then went away and then appeared again. It went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. This star directed them to the exact place that they needed to come. And when the star reappeared and directed them to the exact place that it needed to come, what did they do? When they saw the star, I think when they saw that it directed them to the exact place that they needed to do, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. Now, I know you know the rest of the story, but as I often do, let's just think hypothetically for a moment. Imagine if they would have come to the place and said, "Oh, great star that brought us to this place, We rejoice. You're so wonderful and beautiful. Thank you for doing this. And then they leave and they go back to wherever they came from. Could you imagine if they did that? No, you know what they understood? And this is another good lesson for us. They understood that the star was a means to an end. Sometimes we don't make that distinction. Sometimes spiritually we have to recognize what the end result and the end goal is and what are things that are in place just to bring us to that end goal and that end result. The end goal, the end result is Jesus. It's our relationship with Jesus. Jesus is the one that changes lives. So the star plays a wonderful role in the story. It directs them to where they need to be, but the star is not the end in itself. Jesus is the end. The star brings us to that place. Here's what that means for you and me. All month long, we've been talking about the nativity and these wonderful pictures, and you go home and you see your nativity and whatever, and the nativity plays a wonderful role in the story, but it points us to Jesus. It tells us and points us to that deeper meaning. Imagine if we started worshiping our nativity sets. Let me give you another more practical example. Some of you love your ABF, and you love your Sunday school class, and you love your small group, but do you understand that they are a means to an end? They're there to point you to and strengthen and encourage your relationship with Jesus. Some of you might think this is heretical to say, but do you understand that that's what your Bible is? Your Bible, the authoritative, inspired Word of God, is a means to an end. We thank and praise the Lord that He didn't leave us to figure this out on our own, but He communicated to us through His Word. So we read His Word in order to understand how to be rightly related to Him. And the Scriptures point us to what? To who? To Jesus. Jesus even told us and warned us about this. John chapter 5, one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. This is Jesus speaking. He says this. He says to the Pharisees, "You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life." He said, you guys search the Scriptures and you do a great job of reading the Bible. You do a great job of having your daily devotions. I mean, they had Jesus calling and they had utmost for His, I mean, they had it all. And they were reading it all, daily bread. I mean, they had it all. They were searching and digging into the Scriptures. And they thought that if they just followed the rules and did what the Scripture said and followed their interpretations of it, that they'd be all set. But look what Jesus says to them. It is they, the Scriptures, that bear witness about me. The Scriptures point to Jesus. The star points to Jesus. And He says this, "Yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life." Jesus is the one that gives us life. Jesus is the one that restores and forgives and redeems and reconciles. The Bible points us to Him. The Bible tells us how that works. So the Bible is invaluable in the process. I can't believe I'm going to say this. Don't make too much of the Scriptures. Don't make too much of the fact that you get up and you read your Bible every day. Do you understand that that's why our value says living God's Word? Because we want to be a people that are putting it into practice and living it out. Not just reading it and patting ourselves on the back because we had devotions. The Scriptures point us to Jesus. The star directed them to Jesus. Imagine if they would have got to the doorstep and just left. Or imagine if they would have got to the doorstep and never went in and they just kind of worshiped the star. No, oh, there's one more step. There's one more step. The star has directed us to the place and now it invites us in. And they took that final step, verse 11. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. and they fell down and they worshiped him. Here's an interesting thing to point out, and never saw this before. It's interesting that Matthew tells us that Mary was there, but nobody worshiped Mary. They worshiped Jesus. It's a reminder to us that there are some that make too much of Mary. There are some that make too little of Mary. Nowhere in Scripture is Mary ever worshiped. We should lift Mary up as a great servant of the Lord. We should read her account in Luke that Luke wrote about her and admire and use her faith and obedience as an example. But Jesus is the one that we worship. And that's who they came and worshiped. That's who they came and bowed down before. It was Jesus. The star brought them to that place and it invited them the whole way in. And in that moment, those seekers became worshipers. And they bowed down and they laid their gifts before him. They opened their treasures and they offered them to Jesus. And I love that picture of these guys who their life was interrupted hundreds of miles away. It motivated them to begin a journey towards Jesus. There was questions, there was obstacles, they were provoked all along the way, but God continued to direct them to the place that he needed to come. And that invitation was there for them to come and to worship Jesus. And those seekers became worshipers. And I have to ask, how about you? For some of you, your life has been interrupted, maybe by an event, maybe by a tragedy, maybe by a circumstance. It's motivated you to ask some questions. It's provoked you. It's directed you. Some of you say, I'm not even sure why I'm here today. Maybe you're here today because you've been seeking, and today's the day that you as a seeker become a worshiper. Today's the day that you look at the Savior and you say, today he is my Savior. And you cross that line, you step to the other side, moving from being a seeker to a worshiper. Do you see the role that the star played in their life? Do you see the role that circumstances and events play in your life as God continues to invite people to come, invite people into his story? I believe that the star, the image of the star, not only invites, but I think it also proclaims. It's a reminder to us that this is a story, that this is a proclamation for the entire world. Matthew was writing to a Jewish audience, and from the very beginning, he wanted to convince this Jewish audience that Jesus was the Messiah, the King of the Jews, but he didn't just come for the Jews. He came for the entire world. Isn't it interesting that Matthew, writing to a Jewish audience, included nothing about Jewish shepherds coming and worshiping? Matthew instead took the time to tell us about wise men from the east. Not the eastern part of Bethlehem, not the eastern part of Jerusalem, but hundreds of miles away. Gentiles, non-Jews, invited into the story. So in a sense, the star proclaims to the entire world that this is a message for everyone. Matthew begins his gospel that way. Many of you know, but I'm going to show you anyway, how Matthew ends his gospel. He begins with a come and see event. The star invited wise men to come and see. But Matthew ends his gospel with the proclamation to go and tell. Matthew 28, starting in verse 16. Jesus had died on the cross. He rose again, spent 40 days preparing his followers to begin his church. And at the very end, Matthew tells us this. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. Verse 17, and when they saw him, they worshiped him. Matthew's gospel begins with worship of Jesus, and it ends with the worship of Jesus. It began with the worship of a baby, of a small child, and it ends with the worship of Jesus by his disciples. Isn't it interesting that when they saw him, they worshiped, but some doubted? The responses to Jesus continue to be diverse. I don't think that doubt was unbelief. I think it was more uncertainty. And we could talk a little bit of you know, was this some of the disciples that did not just know how to react in that moment? Was there other people there besides them? You know, we could talk more about them, but I just think it's interesting that Matthew includes that. And then Jesus says this, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, not just of the Jews, not just of the surrounding area, not just of white people, not just Americans, but all nations, all nations. The star reminds us, the star proclaims that this is a message for everyone. The star invites and the star proclaims. The star invites us into the story, no matter who we are, no matter what we have done. It invites us to make his story our story. But the star also invites us to proclaim this message to a hurt and a dying and a broken world. And as we conclude this morning, I want to make sure that for those of you that have been here all month, and maybe even for some that haven't, I want to make sure you understand what we've done this month. When you look at the Nativity, this is a composite of the entire birth story. You say, well, is it historically accurate? And I say, yes, historically this took place. This wasn't once upon a time. This took place historically. But you have to understand that your nativity scene and this nativity scene is a composite of the entire birth story. Was there an angel hovering above the stable? No, probably not. We're not even sure if there was a stable. Could have been a cave, could have been a house. Was everybody there at once? Did the wise men come, you know, right away? Or was it a couple months, maybe even a year later? You know, you can get in and you know, discuss and debate that. The point is that it is a composite of the entire story to remind us of what happened, what God did on our behalf. And I don't know if you've realized it or not, but we not only told the birth story this month, we really told the story, God's story, the story of the whole gospel. So let me just take a moment and put it all together for us. We did it around these eight words. It began week one with the angel and the trumpet. And the angel and the trumpet represented these two words, anticipation and annunciation. The story of the coming of Jesus was not an afterthought. God understood that the problem of man being separated from God would be there, and he put a solution in place from the beginning. And he not only put a solution in place from the beginning, he anticipated that solution. All through the Old Testament, prophecies anticipate the coming of Jesus, the solution to the problem, the coming of the rescuer. He used Old Testament prophets to announce that he was coming. And then he used an angel to announce to Mary and to Joseph and to the shepherds about the coming of Jesus. And what was so special about this coming of Jesus? Well, we looked at that in week two when we looked at Mary and Joseph, and particularly that manger that she laid him in, and we connected it to the words incarnation and humiliation. The incarnation, the coming in the flesh, God in the flesh, the climbing down of God, the whole way down. Though he was rich, for your sake, he became poor, so that out of his poverty, you might become rich. The incarnation for our behalf, the coming of Jesus for us in the flesh, his humiliation, the climbing down, the stepping down of God in order to be that perfect and only once and for all sacrifice. Then we moved on to the shepherds and we talked about participation and adoration. That this is a story for all, that everybody is invited to participate in the story. The shepherds saw, the shepherds heard, they were invited to come, they were invited to tell what they had seen and heard, and they participated by telling the story. They participated by adoring. They came and they worshiped, but they left and they worshiped as well. And you and I are invited to do the same thing. And then finally today with the wise men and particularly that star, it wasn't just an invitation to Jewish shepherds, it was an invitation for all people. This is the message of the gospel that needs to go out to all nations. It needs to be proclaimed to everyone that Jesus is the Savior of the world, the only one that can solve the problem of sin that separates man from God. The Savior needs to become everyone's personal Savior. These eight words to me capture the whole story of God, who he is, what he's doing, and to me it's all wrapped up in this scene of the Nativity. That's why we want you to walk away and never look at your Nativity the same way again. Let me pray. Father, thank you for telling us how we fit into this story. Thank you that it's clearly communicated through your word. Thank you that you sent Jesus in the flesh to be born, to be placed in a manger, to live a perfect life, to die a sacrificial death, and to rise again so that we can have newness of life. Father, may we not make too much of our nativities. May we not make too much of the star and the manger and the angels, but may they point us to you as we seek, as we search, as our lives are interrupted and provoked by you. May we not be seeking our own kingdom, but may we be seeking and going after yours. And Father, my hope and my prayer through all of this is that it's easy to sing that you are the Savior of the world, but we want to be able to come and worship you because you're my Savior. You're our personal Savior. So thank you for the work that you're doing in each of us. Thank you for the encouragement that you bring us. And Father, as we usher in a new year, may we revel in the fact that you came for us. And we worship you for that now in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand, let's sing this last song together. Amen. I hope that that's a reality in your life. We made it. I've never felt, the verse that talks about when I am weak and then he is strong certainly applies to this morning. So I praise the Lord that we got through this here this morning together. So if your guest here would love to be able to connect with you at the welcome gathering, out the doors to your right, down at the end of the lobby. If you have questions, if you're here for the first time, you just want to meet somebody to find out a little bit more about Calvary Church, I'll take no more than 10 minutes of your time. I'd love to meet you there. Have a wonderful, wonderful new year, and we'll see you next week, January 3rd, for the start of our next series. God bless you. We'll see you then.